Well, it is good to see you guys on this special Memorial Day weekend. I'm glad you hung around town. I'm going to call us the smart ones because, you know, the weather's not so nice, so might as well hang around and come worship this weekend. So it's so good to see all of you guys. I'm so glad that you have chosen to come and be here at Trailhead this morning. If you were with us last weekend, you know that we started a new series that we are just calling The Gathering. And as we jumped into this series last weekend, what we started talking about was the fact that this gathering, not necessarily like in this room with these people, but a gathering of people that are followers of Jesus is so critically important. And it's unique. It's different than almost any other gathering. It's not the same as going to a baseball game and hanging out in a crowd. It's not the same as going to a coffee shop and hanging out with friends. Whether we're gathered in a large group or whether we are gathered in small groups, this gathering is unique and incredibly important. So over the next several weeks, this is what we're talking about. We're just kind of asking the question, what is it that makes us unique in this time and this way of gathering? And what does God desire for us in these times? So to kick us off today, I want to play a game. You guys, anybody ready to play a game? All right. JD is ready to play the game. I hope everybody else is ready to jump in with us in this game. So here's how it works. I'm going to show you a picture or two in just a minute. And as we bring up these pictures, I want you to answer with me two questions. And if you know it, just say it out loud. We're family here today, okay? Just say it out as you know who it is. So it may be a corporation. It may be a person. But as this comes up, I want you to answer these two questions. Who are they? And we'll do that one first. Who are they? And then the second question that I want you to answer is, what are they known for? All right? So, and like we're using just short phrases, one or two words, you know, you don't have to go into their Wikipedia biography and read off what they're known for there. So, first picture, what is this? Taco Bell, that's who they are. What are they known for? Fast food, yeah. Fast food, digestive problems, you know, however you want to classify it. But yes, every one of you nailed that one. All right, second one's also a corporation. Who is this? Apple. What is Apple known for? Yeah, electronics. iPhone, iPod, AirPods, you know, the MacBooks, all of that kind of stuff, right? All right, so those were warm-ups. Those are the easy ones. Now I'm going to show you actual pictures of people, and they may not be in their normal setting that you would see them in, so you may have to look twice. I don't know. I think you'll know most of these people, though. All right, this person, who is this? Judge Judy, that's right. She doesn't have on her garb. She doesn't have on her robe. And, you know, and she's gone to that kind of slick back hair look. I don't know what's going on with that. This must be an older picture. Judge Judy, what is she known for? TV show. Yeah, she's a judge on TV. All right. Next picture. Who is this? Carrie Underwood. And what is she known for? Country music. All right. Next picture. Who is this? Kobe Bryant. Yeah, a few of you know. Some of you are. What is Kobe known for? Basketball. All right, just a couple more. Who is this next guy? Einstein. What is Einstein known for? Intelligence, brilliance, yeah, whatever you want to say. I'm pretty sure if he was alive today, my wife would leave me for him. She's always had this thing. I've got to grow my hair out, obviously. But anyway, yes, that's Einstein. All right, next guy. Who is this? Yeah. Gene Peterson. I mean, everybody knows Gene, right? And what is Gene known for? Other than singing up here this morning, what is Gene known for? All sorts of stuff, obviously. So I'm guessing there's a pretty good chance that one of the first two or three faces that you ran into when you started attending Trailhead Church was this face right here. You ran into Gene Peterson. He's known throughout Trailhead because he's always standing at the door. He's always welcoming people. He is always inviting people into our circle here. So last one, answer this with me. What are you known for? Who are you? What do your friends say about you? When people think about you and talk about you, what do they say you're known for? What do they think, hey, this person is important in this area for? You may be looking up and thinking, I don't know. I'm just me. I'm not doing anything special, right? I'm not a country music star. I'm not Gene. I'm not whatever. What you may be looking at this and saying, I don't know really. I'm still trying to figure out this whole thing of who I am, what I'm known for, why I am important to the world around me. And that's part of what we're going to talk about today. But you know, I really believe that if you call yourself a Jesus follower, if you say that I'm a Christian, I'm a believer, I'm following the ways of Jesus, I believe that Jesus defines for us in very concrete terms what our identities should be. If you were with us last weekend, like I talked about a few minutes ago, as we started this series, The Gathering, we started by jumping into the book of John, John chapter 13, and we looked at the place where Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he said, a new command I give you. Do you remember this? Right? He says, a new command I give you, love one another. And then he clarifies that, he defines that, he says, as I have loved you, so you are to love one another. Over the next several weeks, as we continue looking at who we are, why this gathering is unique, what we're doing is we're looking at these one another commands all through Scripture. And last weekend, we laid the foundation where Jesus said, love as I have loved you. That is the foundation of everything else that we're going to be looking at in this series as we talk about the gathering. And so this weekend, we are starting to build on that. And what you're going to see, this thing that Jesus gives us this weekend is the idea that here is the best way to start loving people. This is the key to start loving people. Well, if you were with us last weekend, we said when Jesus told us to love one another, he wasn't saying, I want you to conjure up feelings for other people around you. That's not what he was saying at all. In fact, what he was saying was I want you to do for them, not feel for them. I want you to do for them. And so today we're going to start unpacking that do just a little bit and start looking at what it means to actually love the people around us well with another one another command that Jesus has given us. We're actually going to hang out in the very same chapter that we were in last week. So last weekend we were in John 13. This weekend we're going to back up to the beginning of that chapter, because at the beginning of the chapter he clarifies to some degree what he says later when he is saying, I want you to love one another as much as you love me, or as I have loved you. So just as a reminder of what's going on here, as we get to John 13, Jesus has gone to Jerusalem. He is in Jerusalem. He knows this is the last time that he will be there. He will not leave Jerusalem again, because at this point, he knows he will be killed. He will be crucified. And he's gathered his disciples together, and they've come together in an upper room where they're having the Last Supper. They're sharing a meal together. And it's this end-of-life conversation that Jesus is having with them, where he's starting to tell them, this is what matters most. If you don't remember anything that we've done over the last 3 years, Jesus kind of says, remember what we are doing here. Remember what I am telling you now. So John chapter 13, we're going to jump in verse 1 and just read several verses here. Like we always do, we'll talk about them as we go. So verse 1 says this, before the Passover celebration, Jesus knew that his hour had come to leave this world and return to his Father. So that's what I was saying a second ago. He knows this is it, right? He knows the end is here. He knows that this very night he will be betrayed And before the day has passed, tomorrow he will be crucified. He will die. The next part of verse 1 says this. He had loved his disciples during his ministry on earth. And now he loved them to the very end. It's interesting, that's how John starts off this chapter, because like we saw last weekend, you get to the end of this chapter, and what Jesus says is, here's what I want you to do. I want you to love each other as I have loved you. And John starts this off by saying, this is how Jesus loved us. This is what he did. He loved us all along, and he demonstrated his love to the very end. And this is what it looked like. Going on in verse 2, it says, it was time for the supper, and the devil had already prompted Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. You remember the story. I mean, you know how this goes, right? Jesus is there with his disciples. All 12 of them are together. Jesus has gotten them together for this last meal. They're going to eat together, and eventually Judas is going to take off. He's going to go find the guys that are going to arrest Jesus, and he is going to betray Jesus. So all of that is starting to unfold here. But listen to what verse 3 says. The beginning of verse 3 says this. It says, Jesus knew that the Father had given him authority over everything, and that he had come from God and would return to God. He realizes, he recognizes that the Father has given him authority over everything. Any way that he wants to shape his identity, any way that he wants to shape his legacy, any way that he wants to leave an impression on the guys around him right now, he has the authority to do whatever he wants to do at this point. Let me just ask you a question. If I had the ability, and I don't, if I had the ability to give you the power to shape your life in any way that you wanted, so that you would be known exactly as you wanted to be known by the world around you. Or maybe I don't have the power. If you were going to make a deal with the devil, right? And say, okay, here's what I want more than anything else in life. What is it that you would want your identity to be? I mean, if you could do anything, literally, if you could say, okay, I want to be known like Bill Gates is known for having tons and tons of money, and you could shape your life in that way, would you do that? On the other hand, maybe you say, okay, money is not my thing. I can take money. I can leave money, whatever. But I wish my identity could be shaped kind of like Carrie Underwood. I've always wanted to sing. I've always loved being in front of people. I've always wanted to be a star that was famous, whatever. You know, if you had the ability to do that, would that be the way that you shaped your identity? If you could do anything, literally anything in the world, and you knew it was going to be wildly successful to shape the way that the world looked at you, what is it that you would do? What would you choose as your identity? Jesus is at this point where it says all authority had been given to him. Authority over everything had been given to him. I don't think this is like a new realization. I don't think Jesus comes to this place and just says, oh, wow, okay, I've done ministry with the Father for the last 3 years, but now all of a sudden, boy, I can do whatever I want to do. Everything is given to me. You know, I don't think it's just this sudden realization of, oh, God has given me the authority to do anything. I think it was just kind of the weight of the moment. It was one of those, he knows he's at the end of his life. He knows these are the last hours of his life. And he just feels the weight of, I have the authority of God to shape this moment in any way that I would want to shape it. Right, and he's in that moment, he has that sense of, I need to do exactly what the Father wants me to do to shape my identity in this moment. So look at what happens next in verse 4. It says this, so he got up from the table, took off his robe, wrapped a towel around his waist. Verse 5, and poured water into a basin. Then he began to wash the disciples' feet, drying them with the towel he had around him. I think this is so telling because he's saying, literally, I can shape my identity any way I want to, right? And it says he changes clothes. I don't know if you've ever thought about this story in that way, but that's what he does. He first of all, has been walking around with his robe on as a rabbi. That's the way that people see him. They know him that way. For 3 years, the disciples have been following him, and he has been the one with power and authority, the rabbi who can tell you what to do. If you were here last weekend, you know I told you that disciples were so attached to their rabbis that they had this statement where they would say to each other, their families would say to them, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi, right? You know, as a rabbi, if you're walking around and people, your disciples are following you everywhere, there's a little bit of that power trip kind of feeling of, this is kind of cool. You know, I can lead these people anywhere. I can tell them anything. They are going to do what I say. This is kind of cool, right? And what Jesus does at the moment that he wants people to remember his identity, at the moment where he says, this is what shapes me and makes me who I am, he takes off that robe, takes off the rabbi's robe, and he takes a towel of a servant, and he wraps it around his waist. He changes clothes and says, this is how you should remember me. This is what I should be known for. You know, when he did that, I'm sure as he put that towel around his waist, all the disciples are sitting there and they're kind of like, oh, we totally forgot the whole foot washing thing, right? That was a common thing for them because, as you know, unlike us, they didn't have Nikes, they didn't have closed-toed shoes, they didn't have, you know, whatever shoes you want to wear. They had sandals, they didn't have paved roads, they had dirt paths, and so as they walk these paths, their feet get nasty, they get dirty, and it was just commonplace. If they go into an event, they go into an area where a number of people are gathering, there would be a servant there, a servant at the door, who would wash the dirt off of their feet so that as they came into the room, they were totally clean. These guys all walk in. Jesus walks in with them. There's no servant at the door. And I can just imagine the disciples are kind of looking around and they're thinking, somebody will take care of it. You know, somebody will do that eventually. Eventually, you know, maybe we'll do the whole foot. Or maybe they thought, it just doesn't matter, you know. We don't care if we've got dirt between our toes, under our toenail. It's okay. You know, we'll just go on about our way. And so they just kind of blew it off, right? Like, this is not that big of a deal. It's going to be okay. And then Jesus puts the towel around his waist. And I imagine it just kind of went dead silent in the room. Because he's not under the rabbi's robe anymore. He's got the towel around his waist. And as he starts to do that and starts to wash their feet, it becomes really clear what he's saying to them. He's making this incredible, incredible end-of-life statement to them. This is my identity. This is how you should remember me. And by the way, they did. If you go and read what Paul writes later on in the book of Philippians, he tells us that Jesus stripped himself of all the things that he could have had and took on the role of a servant, humbling himself even to the point of death, right? That's the way that they remembered Jesus after this. Let me ask you a question. Just like the disciples, I think there's so many times we walk into situations and we have those moments where maybe we see something, oh, the feet need to be washed, but it's kind of like, somebody else will get to that. You know, we'll get to that down the road. What is it in your world? What have you noticed that everybody else just kind of brushes off and passes by and says, oh, somebody else will get to that. Somebody else will do that. Maybe it's at your job. Maybe it's in your household. Maybe it's in your church. What is it that you see that you think, well, it must not be a big deal because nobody else is doing it. Maybe somebody will eventually get there. That's where the disciples were. They were saying, somebody will do this. This is somebody else's job, and eventually they'll come around. Eventually they'll do what they're supposed to do, right? If we go on to toward the end of this little section in chapter 13, verse 12, it says this. It says, after washing their feet, he, Jesus, put on his robe again and sat down and asked, do you understand what I was doing? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, because that is what I am. To me, this is one of those moments where it's almost like, any of you guys on Twitter or ever looked at Twitter before? All right, so a couple of you are. On Twitter, you know, you have a certain number of characters to describe things. You can't write out these long paragraphs, all of that kind of stuff. And on what's called your handle, the profile, you've got your picture, and then you've got a description of who you are. And since you've only got a certain number of characters, people describe themselves very quickly in very short ways. So they have a picture of themselves, they have their name or whatever, and then it says teacher, mother, lover of nature. And that may be their description of who they are, what makes them who they are, right? Others will have student and tell about what they're studying very quickly. Can you imagine Jesus' Twitter handle, right? Son of God, authority over all things. I think that trumps like every other description that you could give, right? And Jesus is kind of affirming that here. He's saying, yeah, I've been given all authority. And he's saying, and you know me as your teacher. Rightly so. That's who I am. I am your teacher. But he's kind of saying, but that isn't the main thing that you need to know about me. That's not the thing that defines me above everything else. Says, where you know me as teacher, here's how I really want you to remember me. I want you to remember that I am your servant. That's how he says he should be known. Going on in verse 14, it says, and since I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet. Here's that one another. Here's that each other. He says, here's how you should be known as well. You should be known for washing one another's feet. In verse 15, he says, I have given you example to follow. Do as I have done to you. I love that he clarifies that so well there, because, you know, I think what we want to do as churches oftentimes is we want to read things like this and say, okay, let's get a Bible study together to talk about what Jesus said here, right? Let's get people together and let's study what Jesus is saying right here as he says, we should serve each other. Let's memorize these verses so that we know them really, really well, right? And Jesus says, no. I want you to do what I have done. This is how you love one another. You do what I have done for you. You serve the people around you in the way that I have served you. I think what he's saying here is he's showing us that serving is the single most effective method of loving. If you want to know how to love one another well, if you want to know how to do that without conjuring up all of these feelings, because that's not what he's saying, I think he's saying serving is the single most effective method for loving people well. Guys, over the next few weeks, I'm actually going to harp on this for a little while. I'm going to talk about this a couple of times, and you're going to hear it mentioned. You're going to see it. If you're on social media, you're going to see it mentioned a number of times. This is so critically important. This is the first step toward loving people well. And I believe Jesus is saying, here's what you should be known for. This is what your identity should be shaped around. While the rest of the world says, man, I want to be known for the wealth that I accumulate, or I want to be known for the fame that I receive from the things that I do, while the rest of the world is saying, I want to be known for, God says, I want you to be known for the way that you serve. I don't care about your possessions. I don't care about your fame. I don't care about your influence. He says, I want you to be known in your household, in your community, in your church, for the way that you serve others. If you're like me, there's a little bit of a gut-wrenching kind of thing here. It's like, ugh. If I could choose anything, it would not be that. Right? If I could choose my identity to be shaped and wrapped around anything in the world, man, there's so many things. You know, I remember when I was a kid, I wanted to be an astronaut. I wanted to go to space. I wanted to be known for spending time like on the moon, that kind of stuff. I'll take that any day. God says, here's what your identity should be shaped around. That you are known as a servant of those around you. If you want to shape the world, if you want this gathering to matter, this is where it starts. You know, if you go back into Christian history, this is actually not just good theory. This is not something that Jesus is just saying, hey, this is a good idea. This is something that people actually did. At one point in time, this is something that people actually lived out within the church. In fact, in the earliest parts of church history, there is this period of time where the church is looked down upon, where people think that they are crazy. There are rumors going around that these people apparently eat some guy's flesh and drink his blood, and they are crazy, right? And so everybody kind of looks down on the church for a period of time. But within a matter of literally about 200 years, I know that sounds like a long time, but within a matter of 200 years, it went from people looking down on them saying, these people are crazy, they have lost their minds, to the emperor of Rome saying, we need to learn from these people, we need to be more like these people, and so this is the official religion of the Roman Empire. Do you know what made that shift? Do you know what took them from being the scum of the earth to being held up as the greatest example of what people should be? It was the fact that there were plagues that hit different areas of the world at that time. And what would happen during the plagues is that literally family members would push out their own family into the street saying, you're getting sick, and if you're getting sick, you can't be here because you'll kill all of us. At that moment, when those people were being forced out by their families, at that moment where all the rest of the world are saying, we don't want anything to do with these people because they've got the plague, Christians came to them. They literally came to them and bandaged their wounds and cared for them and loved them. Some of them to the point of catching the plague themselves and it costing them their lives. But they did this, they loved people when even their own families would not love them. And they did it so well that eventually the largest empire in the world at that time said, we need to model ourselves after these people. They serve each other. Whenever they have a chance, they are running to the opportunity to serve those around them. That is who they are, and that is what made Christianity acceptable across the entire world. Jesus, I really believe he says, if you want to experience today what they experienced in the first, second, and third century, in the church, here's where you start. You start by taking off your robe of whatever prestige you feel, whatever position you have been given, taking off your robe, putting a towel around your waist, and saying, I want my identity to be the same as that of Jesus Christ, who, even though he was God in the flesh, did not hold on to that and use that to lord it over other people, but he humbled himself and served in a way that changed the world. Jesus himself, you probably know this phrase, Jesus himself said in Mark chapter 10, he said, "I did not come to be served, but I, as your God, as your Savior, as your Lord, I came to serve you and give my life as a ransom for you." So like I said, over the next several weeks, you're going to have opportunity after opportunity after opportunity to start saying, okay, that's what I want to do. If that's what Jesus does, that's what I want to do. In fact, if you're a part of Trailhead, if you consider this your home, our vision statement, our mission statement is that we want to authentically live and love like Jesus, right? So here's our chance. It's not saying I'm stepping into this great opportunity to be known by the world. It's saying I'm stepping into the opportunity to put a towel around my waist and love people that are currently being overlooked. And so here's what I want you to do. Today, before you leave this place, I want to give you an opportunity to say, hey, at least give me some more information. How can I start serving? Maybe you already know. Maybe you already have someone in your neighborhood that immediately comes to mind and you think, God has been placing them on my heart. That's the family that I need to invest in. That's the person. Those are the people that I need to serve. Maybe you already have that. But if you're sitting here and you're saying, I'm not sure, but I want in. I want to be a part. Here's what I want you to do. I know we don't do this in church often, but I want you to just take your phone, all right? And I want you to go to trailheadwellington.org. Go to the Trailhead website. It's on the screen right here. As you go there, there is a place right under the main header. There is a place that gives you an opportunity to sign up to be a part of serving through Trailhead. There are like 25 different options where you can say, I want more information about this, whether it's children's ministry, whether it's the worship team, whether it's the media, audio visual stuff that's going on, whether it's leading, hosting, facilitating a group in your home, a growth group, whatever it is. There, like I said, like 25 different opportunities for women's ministry, men's ministry, all sorts of stuff. All you're doing by checking that is saying, okay, I want more information. You're not committing your life to this, but you're saying, I do believe Jesus wants me to step in. Let me figure out where I can step in. If you say, I hate doing this stuff on the phone, it's not for me, right? There's a computer actually set up on the first table over here that's already pulled up to the site you need to go to say, please send me more information, all right? So there's one right over there waiting on you if that is easier for you to do it that way. If you need someone to do it for you, if you say, I'm terrible with electronics, John, can you do this for me? I will absolutely help you walk through this process. Here's the thing, though. We're not standing here begging for people to serve Trailhead. What I am standing here asking for is that you would take seriously the identity that Jesus says we should have as believers. Guys, I believe that Trailhead can be an incredible, amazing church, and it has nothing to do with a building, and it has nothing to do with a PA system. It has nothing to do with the organizational structure. It has everything to do with every one of us that are in this place saying, I want my identity to be the same as that of Jesus Christ. I'm ready to step in and start loving people around me that have been overlooked to this point. Would you just open the door and give God the opportunity to start working through you in this way? In Scripture, Paul says that we are, as the gathering, we are a body. Every single part matters immensely. Let's become the body that God wants us to be at Trailhead. Father, we are so, so humbled that you would choose us to step in and work with you, work alongside you, work for you. We are so incredibly humbled that you would call us to be people who shape the world around us, not by lording it over anyone, not by doing something of great prestige and power, but by serving. And I pray, Father, that with whatever we have, whether it's a little bit of time, or whether it's a little bit of money, or whether it's a little bit of influence, I pray that we would take that and we would become the greatest gift to the people around us imaginable. Help us to love and to serve authentically like you. We pray these things in the power of your name, Jesus. Amen.